Hey everyone, welcome to PBS NewsHour's TikTok Talk, and today we are joined by PBS NewsHour correspondent William Brangham. Thank you so much for joining us today.
So good to be here.
Excited to have you, and today we are on YouTube and TikTok. We are talking about the extreme weather, the heat waves that have been running across the globe. So if you all have any questions for William, please drop them in any of our chats on YouTube or TikTok, and we'll get to as many as soon as possible. Ready to jump in?
Ready.
Awesome. So, like I said, we've been seeing some extreme heat waves, extreme weather events wreaking havoc across the globe. Let's start about what we're kind of seeing with these record temperatures around the world.
You're right. What is happening right now is somewhat unprecedented. I mean, we are in summertime. Let's not kid ourselves. It gets hot in summertime. That's a natural thing. But what is happening now globally does seem to be a truly unique phenomenon where we have got, I mean, if we had a globe right here, you could spin that thing around and almost anywhere you point your finger, some place, some nation is suffering through these intense heat waves. It is not limited just to the United States. It is in Asia, it is in South America, it is Europe, North Africa, the United States certainly that we are living in. And we're seeing all sorts of different impacts of this. I mean, they had to close the Acropolis in Greece because of heat, because they were worried tourists were going to pass out. Country singer Jason Aldean the other night at a concert in Connecticut had to suddenly race off the stage because he was about to collapse from heat stroke. People are dying from these things. There are calamities. There are asphalt where the runways are that they've had to close airports because the roads are buckling and they can't land planes. So it is global temperatures in many, many countries are falling all over the planet right now. And this has really driven a lot of governments to say, people, you need to be paying attention to this. You need to look out for yourself because these heat waves are deadly.
Yeah, and it's scary. And I mean, I feel like how long have these weather patterns been occurring? Because I feel like it's kind of increased in the last few months.
It does seem like that way. I mean, for people who remember this, earlier in this month, in July, we saw the first week, I think it was, of July, the hottest days ever recorded in human history on Earth. And so then these heat waves come along, which are, again, driven by a combination of factors. It's not just climate change, which we can talk about. It's driven by stagnant weather patterns, by the jet stream, by these heat domes. There's a lot of different things that are going on right now, but they are definitely occurring simultaneously in multiple places across the globe right now. Mm-hmm. It's very unusual.
And we're talking about, you know, triple digit temperatures that are expected this week, and it's going to affect more than 58 million Americans. 16 states have already issued either heat warnings or heat advisories. So this, going back to where you're talking about heat domes, this excessive heat is triggered by a heat dome, but can we talk a little bit about what that exactly is?
Sure. It is heat dome, like, I don't know, like truck driver. It's one of those terms that kind of explains itself. It is a dome of heat. Basically, it is a widespread high pressure system that holds the weather beneath it in place. And so when air starts to sink, it heats up. And so this high pressure system presses down on the air, which then warms that air. It heats that air and then it holds it in place. Basically, like if you've seen those sort of fancy old glass tops that people put over cakes or baked goods, it is like that. And inside that dome is compressed hot air. High pressure systems also tend to block clouds from coming, so more sunlight gets through, thus it gets hotter inside there. So it makes for this very troubling combination of having these types of hot systems stuck in place. Normally they come and go in a couple of weeks a couple of days. These are seeming to be lasting a lot longer and not rushing off nearly as fast.
We're experiencing it for sure. And I want to jump into some questions that are coming in. And thank you all. Please continue to send in your questions, whether it's on YouTube or TikTok. So let's start with a TikTok by, I always have so much fun reading these. Thcerblayture. I'm sorry.
Thanks for joining us.
No idea how to pronounce it. So there is winter in the Southern Hemisphere. Really, is it really warm there? I think that is what. So there is winter in the Southern Hemisphere. Really warm there. Is it really warm there?
I don't know quite what they're referring to.
I don't know either. If you want to kind of clarify in the chat, we'll come back to you. Let's go to YouTube. This is Bob Tom. Hi, Bob. Thanks for joining us. How are the heat waves linked to climate change, and will it get worse?
That is the $64,000 question. And the evidence for all of those things is, yes, they are linked, and it is likely that they will get worse, absent us as humans and humanity doing something about it. We can get into this later, but there is increasingly good evidence that climate change is making heat waves more intense, more frequent, and making them last longer. Those three things make for a deadly combination. We know that a warmer atmosphere is driving these things. It's, again, it's not the sole thing. It is July. We expect it to be hot in July. That is not unusual. It should be hot in India, in parts of China, in Mexico, in America. That's not different. Climate change is just dialing up the gauge on that. And there's this type of science called attribution science, which is looking at individual weather events. So this particular heat wave will be analyzed by scientists after the fact. And every time we have done this in the past, the evidence shows that climate change is increasingly complicit. And in some cases, scientists believe there's 90-95% chance that a certain event would not have happened and would not have happened as severely had it not been for the underlying impact of a warm atmosphere. So, yes, it is definitely complicit, and it is likely to get worse unless we do something about that.
And thank you for that question. I do want to kind of roll into more on that. Scientists are warning that, you know, these heat waves and extreme weather patterns, you know, are only the beginning. And as climate change accelerates, we might see more and more. Can we talk a little bit about what they mean and what the future possibly could look like?
The future, again, a lot of times you will hear people ask this question of, is this our new normal? Are we going to expect now that we're going to have these crazy heat waves in the summer that are way beyond what we're used to? And the evidence is not that this is the new normal, meaning that we're going to just suddenly be this much hotter and stick with that. All of the modeling evidence of climate change and what we have seen thus far is that these things are continuing to notch upwards. So it's not that we've gotten to a new equilibrium and we're here and now we're set and that's going to be done and we just have to get used to that. It's that it's going to continue to get worse and it's going to continue to get more volatile, so that sometimes you will have winters where we have these colossal snowstorms like we saw out in California earlier this year. Sometimes those, that same system, they're not going to always get 700 inches of snow in the Sierras. Some winters they'll get dramatically less. And that is one of the problems with climate change. It's not that you can say it notches up in this incremental fashion and each new step is the new normal. It's that there's incredible volatility coming forward, and oftentimes those swings get worse. So, yeah, and it's not looking good.
It's not looking. And this kind of leads me to my next question, but, you know, is it too late to kind of reverse these extreme weather patterns through, like, a climate change prevention?
No, there is absolutely no sense that we have to give up hope and just simply accept this. I mean, there's a lot of things that we can do. There's a lot of things that are being done, not just here in the United States, but globally. And the principal thing is to stop contributing to the problem. The main cause of this problem is the pollution that we spit out with our cars and our factories and smokestacks, and how we power the world around us, how those lights and these cameras and all the phones and computers that people are watching us talk on, those are powered principally with fuels that exacerbate climate change. So dialing that back, finding better ways to power our world, that's the principal way you can do it. Secondly, once you stop contributing to the problem and putting more CO2 up in the atmosphere, it's finding ways to get CO2 out of the atmosphere. Because even if all of those electronics and all of those things around us switch to renewable energy tomorrow, we've already put so much CO2 up there that that's going to continue. It lives up there for a while. It doesn't go away right away. So it's going to stay up there for a while, and we have to figure out ways to start pulling that out. And so that's the second path.
And talking about the prevention, you know, have any moves been made towards this, towards preventing future acceleration of climate change?
Yeah, there is a, I cover climate change a ton here at the NewsHour, and it's often people say, oh, it's all doom and gloom and it's awful and there is no good news on this. There is a lot of good news on this front. There is a genuine, real revolution underway in clean energy technology. The cost of wind and solar power right now is plummeting. It is getting to the point where, and these are major Wall Street firms have done these analyses to say that if you're building a new power generating source now, coal and natural gas is less economically potent as renewables, wind and solar. That's an incredible change. That has never been the case, and we are now hitting that tipping point where it is economically smarter, not just environmentally smarter, but economically smarter, because it's cheaper to power your world that way. That is happening right now. It's just the pace is not happening quite at the speed with which we believe we need to do it. So that stuff is underway and is happening. And the goal now, amongst all the environmental community, is to push for that to happen faster. That's the transition that we are in the middle of. And, you know, we see the evidence around us every single day of how bad climate change is getting and the things that it is doing to our planet and the ways in which it is hurting us and costing us trillions of dollars and killing people. And we know that we can start to do something about it. And so that's the tension. We are living with these awful circumstances, but we know we can do things about it. We just have to get going even quicker than we are.
Yeah, and I know everyone dealing with these extreme weather patterns and the heat waves are experiencing it, are understanding that as well. And I just want to remind everybody again, William will be answering any questions you have. So if you have any questions about
the
topic, bring them on. He's ready. So drop them in the chat and we'll get to them. I wanted to kind of transition a little bit because last month, House Speaker Kevin McCarthy was asked about climate change. And this was in kind of the midst of a lot of the Canadian fires were still that were, you know, the smoke was still filling the sky in the northeast of the U.S. When he was asked, he answered with plant a trillion trees. Now, research has shown planting trees can be hugely beneficial. A Swiss study suggested it could be one of the best ways to fight climate change. Is that a realistic solution, and is that something anyone is considering working on?
Kevin McCarthy is right in the sense that if we could put a million mature trees into the ground today, that would have a huge impact. Because trees naturally, as part of their life cycle, they suck carbon out of the atmosphere. They are one of those things that we're talking about. If you need to pull carbon out, a tree does it. It reaches its branches into the sky and its leaves through photosynthesis, pulls carbon out and stores it for the life of that tree. Amazing natural biological system. God bless them. We need trillions of them. The problem is that even if we suddenly turned the entire U.S. government to planting a trillion trees, one, they don't grow instantly. They don't turn into immediate carbon-sucking factories in overnight. They're seedlings that have to grow into full space. Trees also take up a lot of real estate. To plant a trillion trees would take up, estimates are, almost the entire continental United States. So there's a lot of cities and a lot of states and a lot of counties that would have to give up a lot of real estate that they want for all the other things that we use for humanity's living to make space for that. So it is part of the process. The reason why I think Kevin McCarthy and a lot of Republicans like to say, well, let's just plant trees, is because there is, frankly, an allergy in the Republican Party to talking about other climate change solutions. They do not like everything that President Biden has done to push forward this renewable energy revolution. They have been resistant to and fought against. And they like to talk about planting trees. Again, it's not an illegitimate idea, but it is not going to solve this crisis in and of itself.
Yeah. I mean, living in a treehouse doesn't sound half bad, you know.
No, that's right.
I want to jump into a few more questions because we have some rolling in. Let's go to Quiet Epiphanies via YouTube. Will this influence a switch to solar power?
I think it definitely will. I mean, it is already happening right now. One of the most remarkable case studies. If you want to look at the proof that renewable energy is the future, look at the state of Texas. What's the cliche everyone thinks of about Texas and energy? It's oil. Anyone who used to watch the show Dallas knows it's all about digging oil out of the ground and then getting rich and famous and getting divorced to your fancy wives and all of that. But Texas right now is one of the leading wind and solar generating states in the country. They're about to overtake California as the number one solar producer in America. Wind and solar have saved Texas utility payers billions of dollars every single year because it is cheap and it is free and there's a ton of sun in Texas. So all of these switches are happening, and we just have to get out of the way and encourage more of them to happen at a faster pace to address this. So I think on some level people will start to recognize that this is the future. It's free. The sun is going to be operating for our benefit for free. There's no charge that it asks from us for millions and trillions of years going forward. That energy is free. It's there for us to use.
I think people like free stuff, so
yeah.
You know, I think that works. let's go to next one. Max Fortune from on TikTok. Thanks for joining us. Can we reverse our dependence on automobiles?
That is a huge, huge public policy conundrum. Mm-hmm. I mean, there has been decades of federal government subsidies to building highways, to building roads, to building communities that are dependent upon automobiles to get around. I mean, there's certain cities, many, I would say, perhaps 90%, 95% of the cities in the United States, it's impossible to really live without an automobile to get around because people live far from their jobs. Public transportation is woefully inadequate. I mean, there's very few cities that have a legitimate subway system. I used to live in New York for years. Mm-hmm. Nobody in New York really owns a car. Mm-hmm. It's too expensive and it's great to get around on the subway. That's not the case for the rest of this country. So we are a big country. We have to deal with the fact that we have built a society around roads and cars.
Yeah.
The environmental switch on this is that we can move to electric cars, mm-hmm. and that is starting to happen. And again, it's just a matter of building out the infrastructure so that people can charge those cars. The price of those cars needs to continue to come down. The battery technology has to get better. That is happening. I mean, they're a fraction of automobile sales right now. I think it's like 3-5%. It is growing in leaps and bounds. Tesla showed all of the automakers that you can make an electric car that people will want to buy. The prices of those cars have been plummeting. Now, every automaker, not just in the United States, but in the world, is saying our future is electric or all electric. Mm-hmm. It's happening. Again, it's all about the pace of this change.
Yeah, and I know I lived in California for a while, and that is one city that is very, you getting around, you need a car. You know,
right.
It's a large city.
You know, one thing I would add to this too, the skeptics mm-hmm. who are like, oh, you can't just go electric cars, no one's gonna do that. Look at the example of China. Anyone that has been in China recently will tell you that nearly every new car on the road is an electric car. They have solved the problems of charging infrastructure. There are chargers everywhere. They're in apartment buildings. They're out on the highways. They're in stores. They're in convenience stores. Every taxi. There are 6 or 7, I think, companies in China the size of Tesla or bigger that are making electric cars for that market. It's the fastest growing automobile sector in China. So it's not like they're not getting on board with this too. We just need to be doing it at the similar pace.
Yeah, and I will say I've seen more and more electric charging ports kind of popping up here and there.
It's like the
pace.
Beginning. Imagine the first time someone bought a gas-powered car from Ford years ago, mm-hmm. the turn of the century. There were not gas stations all over the country. Did those people sit around and say, well, I can't go from here to Milwaukee because there's no gas stations? That's true. There weren't gas stations. Mm-hmm. They were built by the industry, by the automobile industry,
yeah.
and by the oil and gas companies. The same is happening with the electric cars.
Absolutely.
And it's just timing.
Time, for sure. Let's move on to some more questions. We have the questions coming in, so please continue to send them in. I love when we get a lot of viewer questions. This is from Retired in Motion. I love your username, on YouTube. How severely might the U.S. and global food supply be impacted by climate change?
It, again, is another huge issue. Agriculture is both, strangely, a leading cause of climate change in the way in which we feed ourselves. Mm-hmm. I mean, a good chunk of the Amazon is being deforested to feed and graze cattle for beef production. And that contributes to climate change. We're taking trees out of the system. We're taking a huge carbon sink out of Brazil. But agriculture it requires a lot of water. It requires a lot of land. And we know that climate change exacerbates drought and the ability to access usable, good land to grow crops. Mm-hmm. It is a huge problem. The Colorado River Basin right now, we've all been reporting on this, is experiencing a historic mega drought, and 7 states that benefit from that water are fighting amongst themselves to figure out how are we going to allocate a shrinking river with a growing number of people. Mm-hmm. And the principal use of that Colorado River is agriculture. So the salad bowl of the United States, the San Fernando Valley and that whole area, which gets a ton of that water and grows all the greens that we love to eat and want to keep eating to stay healthy, that's a real problem. It's mm-hmm. a huge issue.
Oh, and this kind of, you know, talking about the water, I love your name as well, Unapologetic American. Unapologetic American. Apologies. On TikTok. Wasn't it hotter during dinosaurs than now? during the dinosaur time than now? Which I love the question.
Yes. The paleoclimate records do show that there have been periods that have been as hot as we are experiencing right now. Mm-hmm. The causes of those, they're somewhat complicated. Yes, we have had heat waves in the past. We have had periods of time where there was as much, if not more, carbon dioxide in the atmosphere than we have now. And those were similarly associated with very, very, very hot periods of time. Sometimes people will bring this up as a way of saying, we don't have to worry about this because, I mean, the dinosaurs suffered a bad end, but that wasn't because of climate change. It's because big rock came from out of space and hit the planet. The issue is that we are contributing to a problem that we know demonstrably is causing a lot of these negative effects around us. Mm-hmm. And so the choice is, do we want to keep shooting ourselves in the foot, in essence, or are we just going to write it off and say we're just going to have to live with this because this is the society we have built? So the specific answer is yes, I do think there are instances where it was equally hot in the past, the long billions and millions of years ago past. But that doesn't mean that we are not suffering through a similar issue here and that we are not suffering the consequences of that today.
Mm-hmm. Very well said. Okay, we have a few more, and I want to jump back.
We should talk about health, too, what people can do to keep themselves safe.
Yeah, that's what I really wanted to talk about. Let me jump into my last few questions,
Great.
And then we'll come back to your viewer questions, because I did want to talk about, you know, a lot of people are experiencing this. How can people stay safe during this time? Because I think that's extremely important for people to know.
This is the mantra that you are probably hearing from your local news if you live in a huge chunk of the country or if you live in so many countries around the world, which is, it's the basics. It's to stay as cool as you possibly can. That means staying out of the sun. Mm-hmm. That means drinking a lot of water. That means if you have to be outside, to stay in the shade, stay in air conditioning. I know the energy costs are expensive and it costs a lot for people and they're reluctant to turn their air conditioners on. And there's questions about the grid, like if everyone's suddenly jacking up their AC, mm-hmm. can a local utility handle that sudden pull of all that energy? Those are all legit issues, but you've got to try to find ways to stay as cool as possible. It's especially problematic for kids, because kids can't control their temperature nearly as much. They also can't express as clearly when they're suffering the potential of heat stroke or heat exhaustion, mm-hmm. they're not as good as communicating how they're feeling. Elderly people as well, biologically, they're not as able to adapt to really high temperatures. So check in on your neighbors. If you know people who are older, you need to look out for them. Check in on them if it's really hot where you're living. The other big issue here, and this is something that we don't talk about nearly as much, is what's called the urban heat island effect, which is that if you look at a map of the United States and you plot where the hottest places are in the middle of a heat wave, it's cities. Why is that? Cities are made out of asphalt and concrete mm-hmm. and black roofs and highways and streets. And all of that, what is basically a different versions of stone, absorb that heat. And they hold on to that heat, and then when the sun goes down and it cools down, they continue to emit that heat. I mean, if you took a brick home with you today, put it in your oven and jacked it up to 400 degrees for a while, when you pull that brick is going to stay hot, even in your air-conditioned home, mm-hmm. for a very long time, and it's going to continue to emit that heat. That's what cities are doing. They're absorbing all of this heat during the day. They don't have a lot of shade, they don't have a lot of reflective surfaces, and that heat continues to emanate for hours afterwards. That's why people in cities tend to be dying much more so than people who live in more rural areas where it's cooler, there's more shade, buildings are spread out, it's not a landscape completely covered by hard mm-hmm. concrete surfaces. That's one of the big problems that we're facing. It also points to one of the big solutions, which is there are things that we can do. Back to trees being a solution. Not only do they suck carbon out of the atmosphere, they are a fabulous source of shade. Mm-hmm. Anyone that has sat under the canopy of a huge tree on a hot day knows it's much, much cooler under that tree. Planting trees in cities, making roofs not black, which absorb the heat, but lighter colored, making streets which are black and not light colored. Anything you can do to reflect that sunlight off so you're not baking everything that we are living in, mm-hmm. but finding ways to bounce that sunlight back off so that it doesn't absorb the heat is another big solution. Again, that's not on individuals to solve. That's on cities and city planners. And we're starting to pay attention to this now. But again, just like we built highways that make car living the de facto norm in America, we have built largely dark surfaced concrete mm-hmm. cities and pack them all together with not nearly enough trees, and that is causing a huge problem too.
Yeah, and I wanted to ask, or add, I guess, to it, animals. How can we talk a little bit about the safety of animals, if you have any information?
Yeah, I mean, animals suffer the same problems that we suffer from. Mm-hmm. I mean, our the pets that we live with, they suffer the same way. They're also wearing fur coats, which we don't get to do.
Yeah.
They also can't communicate when they're really suffering as well. I mean, I've had cases where Washington, D.C., where I live, is so hot that my dog goes outside, and depending on the color of the road, like sometimes the really black asphalt on older driveways burns her feet. And
same
she's like,
mine.
You know, she's got her, she can barely stand there. And I'm thinking, I'm wearing shoes. I don't know that. Mm-hmm. She can't communicate that. It's only because I can see it. So again, the same things apply to animals as well. Keep them inside as much as possible. Try to have them outside on the cooler parts of the day, mm-hmm. at the beginning of the day or the end of the day. Give them lots of water. Give them shade if they have to be outside. All of those same things.
Yeah. Stay very vigilant too, you know, about everybody around you. If someone looks like they're exhausted, looking a little, you know, hot, also very much Keep an eye out for one another, I would
exactly.
say that. I'm going to try and get one or two more questions in if you have some time.
Yeah, great.
All right. John Kilinowski, I believe it is, from YouTube. Do you think a south to north migration will help, and if so, when?
I'm assuming he's talking about a south to north human migration.
I think so. Could you clarify? Yes, I think that is what he was talking about.
I don't know how that would help. Per se. I mean, I guess the idea being that if people are moving away from the hotter parts of the southern hemisphere into the north, I don't know about that helping, because people are going to, you know, humanity generates a lot of carbon almost no matter where they live. It's really a function of the economic status of those humans. You know, Western Europe, America, we pump out a lot more carbon. China pumps out a ton more carbon. That's a reflection of their economics, not about where they are living. But the overall human migration, and this is another big concern over climate change, is enormously disruptive, and I would argue not helpful in the slightest. I mean, you simply look at what happened when the Syrian refugee crisis occurred in Europe, and a few million people moving into Northern Europe, and the political upheaval that that caused by those people arriving in countries that weren't necessarily ready for them, or in some cases didn't want them. That was enormously problematic. You look at a nation like Bangladesh, where tens of millions of people live just within inches or a few feet of sea level. If a million Bangladeshis are suddenly forced by a certain level of sea rise to move, right now when those border crossings happen with India, people get killed over that. There is enormous conflict over that. If you're talking about millions of people moving, that is an incredibly fraught thing. I mean, simply look at the struggles we have in the United States over immigration and migration. That is a people moving from the South to the North, and it is enormously disruptive for those people and what their trauma and the lives they have to live. And it's also traumatic politically. Look at what's happening in the United States in debates over immigration. So I don't know if a southern to northern migration is the fix for us, sadly.
Yeah, and I wanted to get this next question because I think it's important. So I think we're going to make this our last question, but it's from Quiet. What government programs or assistance are available to help average to low-income Americans deal with climate changes? Are there more than one way?
I don't know. It's a good question, and I don't know specific governmental programs that one could identify as being, this is meant to help people in X community deal with climate change. There's all sorts of downstream effects of climate change where people are being helped. So that is flood insurance. The government covers that for places that tend to flood a lot, which we know gets worse because of climate change. There's people that can get help paying for their utility bills, which we know is something that gets exacerbated because of climate change in certain places. I don't know of any particular program that is specifically targeted for this is aid for climate change. But again, a lot of the peripheral effects of climate change are helped in the sense that, you know, a health insurance program that helps low-income individuals in Arizona, those people who suffer from heat stroke, pass out on the street, they're going to be aided by those programs. So it's hard to say that these are all climate change programs, but the way that health and utilities and home repair and all of those things are supported by the government, I mean, the government is paying for the downstream consequences of climate change every single day in colossal numbers. One of our colleagues at ProPublica has done an incredible amount of reporting about the billions and billions of dollars that the government spends to ameliorate all the different impacts of climate change around the world. It's some of the things that I talked about. So again, I don't know if that is considered a governmental program, mm-hmm. but we're paying for it, and people are still suffering because of it.
Yeah. And unfortunately, this is a topic that is not going anywhere anytime soon. So we'll have more to come, and hopefully we can have you to join us back
again.
Anytime. Thank you again, William, so much, and we look forward to next time.
My pleasure, Deema. Thanks for everyone for all your great questions.
Yes, thank you all, and have a great rest of the week. NewsHour, this is Tick Tock Talk, and I'm Deema Zein.